even if you were somehow able to prove that this universe was created by a God, it's still a huge leap to go from God created everything to this God created everything.
Right. Good question. I think that the reason we know that it is the God of the Bible who created everything is that it's really in the scripture that we find the most consistent understanding of who this God claims to be.
And wouldn't a Muslim or, you know, a person of any other religion say the same thing about their God?
I think they could say that, but then you'd have to test that claim by what their understanding of God is. And that's where I'd say that all these other gods fall short. As a matter of fact, there were people in church history who said that in order to come to an understanding of truth, it's a matter of belief first.
That's ridiculous.
In other words, we don't... Well, it's ridiculous because your mind has been made up against it.
Let me ask you this. Other than your religion, do you use that train of thought with anything else? Do you believe before you're proven with anything else? Maybe school or anything, just everyday common sense things. Do you believe before you see, before you touch, before you're able to somehow prove it to yourself?
Well, I would say that if you mean if I learn something...
No, I mean, I'm talking very simple terms, like let's say you're catching a bus. Do you believe that the bus has arrived before you actually see the bus? This is just an example. Or do you not believe the bus is actually there until you see the bus?
When I have a bus approach me, I can understand, okay, by my senses, here comes a bus. So I see it, and then maybe on your view, I would believe that it's there. But when we're dealing with actually a God who says, I am, we don't have any way to physically, sensually test that initially. So that's why I say belief has to come first. And then I would also say once we, and I would say that it's a belief that's similar to a bowing of the knee or bending of your heart. You believe that God exists by saying about the Christian God, yes, you are real. And then he opens your eyes to see that kind of belief actually makes sense with every other area of life. So it's a belief in order to know. That's what I'm trying to describe. Maybe not.
So you would agree with me then that it would be hard, if not impossible, to get to the know stage without believing first. You just basically said that, right?
Yeah, and in fact I say it's not only it is impossible for you to come to believe him unless he shows you who he is.
So we're talking about the F word, right? Faith. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And I would say he has shown you who he is. I think that we have to be clear. There is a sense in which everyone knows that there is a God.
You're saying me too.
Yes.
But okay, before we get to that though, let me ask you this. Wouldn't you also have to believe in every other religion under your logic?
If I were saying, you know, if I said, I think your point is to say, I would believe that the Muslim God is correct, and then I would know that he's correct. I would believe that the Hindu gods are correct, and then I would know that they're
correct. Well, my point is more specifically, if you don't do that, if you don't believe in all of them, then you can't rule them out according to your own logic.
No, actually, that's a good question. I would say I would be able to rule these out, and it's simply because if I believe the Christian God is true, he has told me that all the other gods are incorrect. So I'm only allowed to say that he is correct.
Okay, now let's go to something you were saying right before we got to that point. You were saying that God has proven himself to me.
Mm-hmm.
You would say to everyone?
I would say.
All atheists included, huh?
Mm-hmm.
But what I would say, my first initial response to that would be, well, obviously not if I don't believe in him. You know, so what would you say to that? In other words, you know, if God had proven himself to me, I would believe him. It's just that simple, right?
No.
Okay, explain it.
I would say that a reason why you have not chosen to receive what he has shown to you is that you have chosen to believe something else about the evidence. In other words, there's evidence all around you. And we talked about this last time a little bit about the trees and the sky and the amazing intricacies of our body. You know, you're choosing to believe that, in fact, God did not create that. And so you are...
That's actually not true, because belief is not a choice. I mean, I can't help but to believe something if it's proven to me. I can't, you know,
okay,
choose
let me ask
to
you,
believe
who,
things.
Okay, where did these things come from then? What do you believe about where these things came from?
Well, you know, just like I said last time, I don't know. I have no idea where everything came from, or where anything came from, however you want to look at it.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that's my official stance. Again, I'm not saying that this God or that God or that God didn't create everything. I'm saying that I don't believe any of it unless or until it's proven to me. You know, so I'm pretty neutral in the sense that it's not like you're saying God exists and I'm saying God doesn't exist. You're saying God exists and I'm saying, well, I don't know. How do you know?
Okay. To say I don't know, and I think we discussed this last time, to say I don't know means to say no to God, because God himself said he created it. And to look at what
every
he
God
said
that. And right. you're acting like
but
that's exclusive
me.
To your God.
It is. But you're asking me, right? I'm not going to speak for
But I'm saying under that logic, if you're giving me that logic, then you should also believe in all these other gods, because they also say it. So if the reason that I should believe is because God said so, then, you know, it creates an impossible situation where we, according to your logic, has to believe all of these different gods, because they all say so. In other words, what makes your God so special?
He has shown you the evidence. He has told you he gave you the evidence. And now you are saying to him, I'm just not sure. You want something from him, and he's saying to you, I've already given it to you.
God is all powerful, right?
He is.
So surely if a human being can prove something to me, you know, which happens a lot, you know, I'm not going to use an analogy here, but, you know, people prove things to me all the time. They show me things, you know, not necessarily in the debate atmosphere, but just, you know, I went to the store yesterday. I bought a new jacket. Show me the jacket. Let me touch the jacket, whatever. Cases like that. So that happens all the time with human beings. Why is it so hard for an all-powerful God to prove something to a mere human being that he supposedly created? In other words, you're saying that God is basically trying to prove something to me, but, you know, it's not working. Surely, I mean, you know, I'm not a dumb person. I mean, surely if God actually proves something to me the way that, you know, you can prove to me that you...
Right. And this is really the question of, we're dealing with something that's beyond a sense. We are dealing with something beyond the sensual experience, but still includes the sensual experience. It is involving the trees and the clouds and you and me, but it goes beyond that. To use an analogy of, well, I've bought a shirt and I can show you the shirt. Is not a one-for-one analogy. That's comparing apples with oranges, because we're talking here about proving the existence of a spirit being. And if we're talking about the Christian God, we're talking about someone who said, I have exhibited myself all around you. You are swimming really in an ocean of my self-revelation.
He's given us all free will, right? To do what we want to do.
After a fashion.
What do you mean by that?
I mean that we can choose within the way that we are designed.
But it is our choice, though. God is not. It's not like a puppet master thing when he's choosing for us.
Right.
So doesn't that alone limit the definition of God? He's no longer all-knowing, in other words. If I choose to wear... In other words, if he don't know what I'm going to do, then he's not all-knowing.
Right. I think what you're saying is that if we have a free choice, that means we could choose to wear green or red. And if that is truly a free choice, then God doesn't know what we're going to do.
So he's therefore not all-knowing.
And I would say that that's probably a misunderstanding of freedom, of choice, and of... Well, really... When I talk about the fact that God knows everything, I do talk about the fact that he has ordained everything. In other words, everything that takes place in the world has already been decided by God. Nevertheless, there is still a responsibility and a freedom that he has given to men.
That's a very direct contradiction. You just said every choice or everything that happens was decided by God, so that means it's no longer a free choice then. You can't have both.
Well, the scripture would talk about both. God gives us a freedom but it's not an unlimited freedom. He gives us a freedom to choose within our nature. And if my nature is to like red, then I'm going to choose red. That's still a free choice, but he knows it at the same time.
He knows what you're going to do.
Contradiction. Right.
So when you go out, or when a person goes out and sins, for example, mm-hmm. he knows that that's going to happen. Obviously, he knows because he made it that way. Yet,
I wouldn't say he made it that way.
But didn't you just say that everything that happens, God
he determined, may happen? But there's a. This is we have to look at it a little bit more deeply than he just said, Marcel, you're going to say X, Y, Z, because he gave you a free will to choose to say X, Y, Z. He knows you're going to say X, Y, Z, but he doesn't force you to say X, Y, Z.
MarcelLee.com.
But if he knows you're going to say it, you know, obviously if he created you, you know, he basically like wrote the whole story out of what everyone's going to do.
Right.
I don't see how you keep going back to free choice, to free will. It can't be free will if that's the case.
It's not.
It's like writing a story with characters and then saying that whatever your characters do, they're doing it on their own free will.
Right, exactly. That's what I'm saying.
But that's impossible, I'm saying, if you're the one writing the story.
Well, it's impossible for us to understand. I mean, you're trying to say something about what God can and can't do as a human, right?
So you're saying God's able to contradict himself and
no,
get away with it.
I'm saying that you don't understand what God ultimately has done in creating us with free wills and yet determining everything.
But you do understand that?
No, I don't understand it either. I'm not saying it's a contradiction. What I'm saying is that I'm limited. I'm a human. So there's a dimension of reality that I can't have.
So basically, and I don't want to, you know, assume things about you, so I'm going to ask. Would you say that anything you don't know or anything that seems to contradict in the Bible, you would just throw into that category of, well, I don't know, you know, God does things in mysterious ways? Don't you think that's sort of a cop-out?
Well, for you it may be. For me, it's just a matter of submission.
Submission?
Yeah, because
it's blind, total blind faith, basically.
No, not total blind faith.
That's exactly what it is, though.
On your view, on my view, it's submission. There are things that we don't understand that we do have to just submit and say God does work in mysterious ways. But there are other things where he shows us that as we get to know him more, we understand why. And we understand some of the connections. But it really goes back to the fact, Marcel, of who is king. If God is king, then he can say and tell us what to do.
If God is king, but you always start the premise with the conclusion. You know, you're assuming that God exists and, you know, in your premise.
And you're assuming that you don't know. So who's right?
I don't know. I know I don't know. I'm not assuming that. I know I don't know. Which is
how do you know you don't know?
A
circular argument?
No, sort of I was going to say oxymoron, but it's not oxymoron. I
know. Okay, how do you know you don't know?
How do I know I don't know?
Yeah.
Well, because if I knew, I'd know. Right?
So you don't know because you don't know.
Well, if you're talking about in terms of the reason I don't know?
Yeah.
Well, I would say I don't know because of lack of evidence in this situation. But yeah, I know I don't know, because if I knew, then I'd know.
I mean, you're right. If you did have if you knew that this was a table, then you would know what it is. What I'm asking is, you are saying that you don't know based on what seems to me a statement that sounds a lot like what you're accusing me of, and that's a circular argument because you're saying you don't know based on the fact that you haven't been proven. And so that just seems to be, if you were...
How is that circular?
Because if you're not proving, if something is not proven to you, you're assuming that it isn't proven to you or that it hasn't been proven to you. And therefore...
But listen to what you just said. You just said, if something isn't proven to me, then I assume that it's not proven to me. Think about what you just said.
Right. That's what I'm saying you're saying.
Yeah, and I am saying that, but think about what you just said. You're saying, if something isn't proven to me, I'm assuming it isn't proven to me, which I should do, which makes sense.
Okay, and I guess what I'm saying is that that's the same thing as a similar thing to my beginning with the fact that God is the true God, and he has told me about life. You are,
But I'm not assuming, I'm not, no, you can't, that's just wrong comparison. I mean, when I ask you questions about God, you start off by saying, well, you know, if God is what the Bible describes him as, then of course he can do this and of course this and of course that. And, you know, which is obviously stating the your conclusion that God exists in your premise. I'm not doing that. I'm just saying I don't know from the start. If I was arguing that God didn't exist, and I started off by saying, well, you know, if God doesn't exist, then of course this and of course that, then you would have a point. And I had a whole, not a whole list, but I had other questions I wanted to ask you. Like,
go for it.
But, I mean, I'm thinking that you would just give the same answer, that God just works in mysterious ways and you don't know. Like, for example, if he loves everyone so much, as the Bible claims, why does he let, you know, all these bad things happen to people? I'm sure you get that question a lot.
Yeah, and I would say...
For example, innocent, I'm just going to say innocent babies, for example. Why does he let innocent babies get killed, beat, molested, and whatever, you know, if he supposedly loves everyone?
Right. That's a good question, and I don't claim to be able to answer this one fully.
Okay, go ahead.
But I would say that the reason why all these things are happening will ultimately work out for his glory. In other words, there will be justice that is given, and so certain types of things that we may see happen.
Can I just throw a quick question in while you're? Could he prevent it if he wanted to?
Sure, and he often
he just chooses not to.
So
we're talking about the cases where he don't. You're talking about the cases where he don't.
Right.
He just chooses not to. He just says, well, you know, this baby's about to get molested. This baby's about to get beat up, get burnt, and get stabbed or whatever. I'm just going to let it happen.
I am saying he is allowing it to happen, but that there is something that goes beyond. And that is the fact that he, like I said, gives people a choice to behave in a certain way, and he will hold them accountable for that choice.
Even if that choice affects his other people.
Mm-hmm.
Would you say that God is perfect?
Mm-hmm.
Let me ask you this. If God is perfect, why is it or how is it that I can imagine a better God? I can imagine a God that wouldn't allow innocent children to be hurt and, you know, so on and so on. So if your God is perfect, how is it that I can say, you know, it would be better if God didn't allow this or didn't allow that.
Let me ask you a question. Do you think that God and humans are on a different level?
According to your definition of God?
According to yours.
Well, I don't believe in God.
But you just asked me about you just told me about a perfect God.
Right, I'm saying in a hypothetical sense.
Okay, so in a hypothetical sense, do you think that there's a difference between you and God?
Well, yeah, obviously, if it's a God, yeah. It would have
so
to.
You are a human telling me about someone who is different than a human. How is it that you're able to do that?
What do you mean, how?
How is it that you can even imagine a perfect God?
Well, because I'm going to go back to the children example. A God who, just let's say one less child is hurt. That would be a better God, you know. And according to your definition of God, I shouldn't be able to even imagine a better God because it's a perfect God. Would you agree with that?
According to my definition,
I don't want to put any
God,
words in your mouth.
You shouldn't be able to imagine another God?
I mean, if your God is perfect,
right?
I shouldn't be able to imagine a better God, or, you know, in other words, your God can't be perfect if I can imagine a better God.
Right, and I guess I would say that the answer to this question is the fact that God allows you, like we said, to have a free will in regard to certain things. And so he's given you the choice to think, and he's given you the choice to even use that thinking to imagine on your view that there is a better God.
You don't think that would be a better God, a God that doesn't allow children to be molested, hurt? You don't think it would be
better?
I think
that the reason why we see these things happen is maybe...
But your answer is no. Your answer to that question is no or yes?
To the question that there cannot be another God who is better?
No, do you think that if there were... Do you think that it would be better for a God not to allow those things to happen?
No, because this is what he is determined to happen, and he is a good God, he's a perfect God, and he can allow these things to happen for reasons that, you know, maybe lie beyond what we can imagine.
Okay.
Or that we won't find out till later. You know, there is a story about a guy named Joseph who was sold by his brothers into slavery and who was beat up before that, but who in turn was used in the place where he went to help save his brothers. So on the one view, he was given something that was terrible, okay? Now, we would say, well, why did God allow that? And the answer is that this person, Joseph, was actually ended up being used by God to help save his brothers. So what they intended for evil, God meant for good. And I think that kind of thing happens all the time.
Earlier you said you were a sinner, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Why do you sin?
I sin because I don't allow the things that God has told me to do and the resources that he's given me in his word and the Holy Spirit to control me.
Mm. Just give me an example of a sin that you've committed recently.
MarcelLee.com.
Well, I don't think I always speak kindly to people. For example, I know I've sinned. I'm just trying. I try to forget about them rather quickly after I confess it. But if for example, I were to say something in anger to someone, playing basketball with them or whatever the case may be, and I said something I shouldn't have said, then I've sinned. I've gone against what God has told me to do and how he's told me to treat other people.
Okay, let's say that you're on a basketball court and you say something out of line to someone, mm-hmm. okay? Which is a clear violation of your rules, right? Let me ask you this. I want you to be honest. I want you to really honestly answer this question, okay?
I will honestly answer the question.
Let's say that, that morning of the game, a billionaire, Bill Gates, or some billionaire approached you and said, if you don't use any foul language during the whole game, I'll give you $1 billion. And I want you to be honest. Don't just give me the typical righteous answer. Be honest, from your heart as a human being. Would you have been able to play that game without using the offensive language for the money?
Sure.
To do what anything you want to do, you would.
Yeah.
So can't the argument be made that, at least in that case, the money is more important to you than your own God? If your God is telling you not to do something, you did it, but yet you wouldn't do it if someone paid you.
Right, yeah.
Doesn't that say a lot about you as a believer?
It does.
So can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, it says it really says that I've made a choice like many people have made a choice, and that is to love something else other than God. And that's the problem.
So doesn't that sort of make you a hypocrite in this whole discussion?
Well, a hypocrite I would see as someone who is consistently doing these things, consistently using foul language on the basketball court, and someone who is saying, I don't use foul language on the basketball court.
So the numbers matter.
Well, not necessarily. It's the kind of thing that John talks about in terms of practicing sin. If someone practices sin, then they really haven't been changed.
But if you sin every once in a while, it's okay.
It is a kind of thing where we do sin, and we are in the struggle to overcome sin. But if it's something that we are doing without any kind of thought regarding.
I hate to interrupt you, but we have 1 minute left. If you have any last message that you want to give out.
Right. I could just answer this question. It would be, to practice sin means to make it a habit in your life.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If I'm going to sin habitually, I'm going to do it. I mean, I don't know if we could put a day on it, but every day. Okay, and I'm going to do the same thing every day. And this is actually what it means in John, the letter of 1 John, to practice sin. But as Christians, we don't practice sin. We have been changed by God's grace, and we have the ability to not do that. And that's what I would encourage everyone to consider, is who is it that can actually help you to stop sinning? And that is Jesus Christ, and he commands us to stop sinning. So we have no other choice but to obey.